For more information, visit freeviewnz.tv.
Good evening, thank you. I'm Rawdon Christie, and welcome to the Auckland electorate of Epsom for tonight's second swing seats debate. This is the Jaffa heartland. Leafy suburbs like Parnell, Remuera and Epsom, which make up this electorate, are where Auckland's wealthiest people live. So predictably, this has always been one of National's safest seats, until 2005, when Rodney Hyde took it for ACT. Now he must hold it. If he loses, he and ACT will be out of Parliament. That's why it's a vital swing seat, one we'll all be watching on election night. We'll meet the candidates contesting the seat in a moment, but first I'd like to introduce you to my co-host for tonight, the presenter of TVNZ's Backbenchers show, Wallace Chapman.
Rawdon Christie, thanks for inviting me. It's great to be here in Epsom, and it's wonderful being here in the Ray Freeman Arts Centre at Epsom Girls Grammar. Now we've got this is Helen Clark's old school, and we've got some students here. Do you feel the sense of Helen Clark when you come to school every morning?
Yes.
Oh, you do?
I guess so.
And, of course, one of the most prestigious schools in the country, Auckland Grammar. How are you tonight?
Oh, very well, thanks.
Do you spend a lot of time at Eggs?
Now and then.
Now and then. OK. Rawdon, back to you. We've got a number of questions from the audience for you later.
Great. Thanks very much, Wallace. All right, let's meet our candidates. First up, 27-year-old Kate Sutton grew up in Auckland's eastern suburb. She has an MA in politics from the University of Auckland, where she was president of the Students' Association. She works for Landco as their public affairs and corporate responsibility manager. Kate Sutton also chairs the Tamaki Community Board, is women's vice president of the Labour Party, and she's the Labour candidate. Evening, Kate.
Well, we're at the Auckland War Memorial Museum, which is on the edge of the Epsom electorate, and it really is one of our special green spaces, our special heritage areas, which is really important for Auckland. And so Epsom's right in the centre of Auckland. It's one of the smallest electorates, and we're really lucky to have some of Auckland and New Zealand's most iconic spaces. We're at the University of Auckland Faculty of Education campus in Epsom. Education is really a passion of mine. It's an area that I'm really interested in, and it's an area that the people of Epsom are really interested in. A high-quality education is so important for them. It's such a great faculty and such a great campus, and it's fantastic to be right in the centre of Mount Eden. We're in Nuffield Street, which is right in the middle of Newmarket, which is Auckland's fashion capital. I think that Newmarket represents an area where we've had strong economic growth. We've seen New Zealand's fashion designers go from here to overseas and do really, really well. And we've built a brand for ourselves over there. And we've also seen Newmarket grow. And over the last 5 years, it's just gone through an amazing transformation. And it's such a great place to come and shop.
Kate Sutton there. Now, our second candidate, veteran left-wing politician Keith Locke. Keith has been a Green List MP since 1999. With a PhD in psychology, he's a former sociology lecturer, but these days is the Green spokesman on foreign affairs. And, of course, last election, he promised to run through Epsom naked if Rodney Hyde won the seat. Mr. Hyde did, and Keith kept his promise. Fortunately, he has dressed for us tonight, Keith Locke.
Well, this village is the heart of the Mount Eden community. It's got fantastic meeting places like this cafe. It's unlike some other suburbs of Auckland or Queen Street, this community was not totally run over by Rudgenomics commercial greed. The old buildings remain around the village, and it does give it a village atmosphere. It is a real village. We're standing on the top of Mangapo, or Mount Eden, which is an icon, really. It's a wonderful place to walk up the top of. You get away from it all, away from all the politics and the hustle and bustle of the city. There needs to be a big plan to take the buses off the road, make it a bit more tranquil. We're on a walkway on the western side of Hobson Bay here, just below Parnell, and when this walkway is completed, people will be able to go from Rimuir on foot around on the flat to the city. That'll be fantastic. And I think this shows how important Hobson Bay is for both recreation and for alternatives to car travel.
Well, that's Keith Locke there. Now to our third candidate. Richard Wirth has a list of postgraduate law degrees. He speaks French for recreation and, among other things, climbs mountains and enjoys Korean classical music. He's been a captain in the Naval Reserve and was a partner and chairman of the law firm Simpson Grierson. Richard Wirth won Epsom in 1999 and lost it last election, but he's remained a List MP and now he's back trying to win the seat for National.
So we're at Auckland Grammar School, which is arguably the best school in the whole of New Zealand. One of the issues here, apart from the excellence of the school and the students who are turned out from it, are these zones, these enrolment zones, around Auckland Grammar School, around Epsom Girls Grammar School, and around a number of other primary schools. I'd say without exception, they're all good schools. They've all got high decile ratings. Odyssey House are a drug rehab centre. This is their administrative headquarters, and like all electorates, there's a big issue in Auckland with drug use, and particularly methamphetamine and pee use. Sadly, we have the headquarters of organised crime in this electorate. Just down the road is the headquarters of the Hells Angels. So we're here at the Epsom Showgrounds. Behind me is a very old, old grandstand, but on the other side, there's the latest work that sees now this as a completed high-tech showgrounds. There are a raft of heritage issues in Epsom. One relates to the retention of historic buildings, including residential buildings.
Richard Wirth. And finally, a man who needs no introduction, Rodney Hyde, the ACT leader, former university lecturer, economist and Dancing with the Stars star. Tonight he's taking a few moments off his nationwide campaign to be back home in the seat he won just 3 years ago. Good evening, Rodney.
This is the temporary station for Newmarket for the train. Go down there and it's $1.40 and you whoosh straight into town. And we're building over here a transport hub of $30 million. Transport's a big issue in Epsom with the congestion on the roads. Well, we're in Broadway here in the heart of the Newmarket Business District, and what this does is remind ourselves that, particularly in Epsom, a lot of small businesses, a lot of small business people employing and creating the prosperity. It's the engine room of New Zealand. That's what provides us with our standard of living. Well, this is Parnell, which is the oldest suburb of Auckland. And here we have the Herds building, which when we were kids we used to get the Herds barley sugars, which were a famous sweet. What makes Epsom special is really its history. And so you have this little village, and it's the same as in Mount Eden, and it's protected as a little community, and you feel part of something, you feel part of history, and you feel connected to Auckland and to New Zealand's history here.
So, people of Epsom, who do you support? Do you support Kate Sutton?
Yeah!
Or maybe do you support Richard Wirth? Or perhaps you might support a fully clothed Keith Locke.
Yeah!
Both me. Or the leader of Camp Epsom, Mr. Rodney Hyde. Gordon, yeah! Over to you.
Okay, thanks very much, Wallace. Okay, we're going to take a very short break here, but coming up, the guts of it, the first of our issues, and one central to this electorate, education.
News when you want it.
You'll always be able to access the most up-to-date news.
On TVNZ7.
And breaking news.
Backed by the nation's biggest news resource, One News.
It was a significant physical assault.
With updates on the hour, every hour.
We'll now cross live to report
now it. Now the government wants to clamp
South
down.
South Auckland police are continuing their hunt.
And a full hour-long bulletin every night at 8.
For more information, we cross live now.
A longer look at the day's big stories.
Stories that count.
It's news for New Zealanders throughout the day on TVNZ7.
the respected host.
Where do you draw the line?
The high-powered guests.
We are joined this morning by Senator John McCain.
This week with George Stephanopoulos.
I'm so happy that she is part of the team.
Debating American issues.
Those are ridiculous charges.
That affect us here at home.
This is not just the financial markets here, it's global.
Hot off the satellite and up to date.
How much worse is this going to get?
This week with George Stephanopoulos. First on Mondays at 7:10, TVNZ 7.
Each one of our candidates has got at least one postgraduate degree, and this is the electorate where parents are willing to pay a premium just to get into the so-called grammar zone. So what more appropriate issue to start with than education? Here's Wallace Chapman.
Education, where people have flocked to Epsom to give the kids a good education, and the place is home to some of the country's finest schools. So residents are interested in policies that will lift educational standards.
Parents go to great lengths so their kids can attend the prestigious schools. Kay Thompson moved to a one-bedroom flat in the zone so her son could go to grammar.
It was 4 months before I found the one-bedroom, and we were in there living under extenuating circumstances. It wasn't pleasant. And then to find somewhere as a solo mother that I could afford, well, I was just lucky.
Zoning's a contentious issue. Attempts to alter zone boundaries threaten property prices. Auckland Grammar on a listing can add several zeros to the value. Remuera real estate agent Lila McDonald says there is a big demand for places in the grammar zone.
If they want to send kids to their public schools, they want to be here because that's the only way they could get in.
Some parents say the popularity of the schools means problems with overcrowding and standards.
I think there's 38 kids in Dominic's class, whereas my daughter goes to a private boarding school and there's 12 kids in her class. So her marks are incredibly better because she gets that one-on-one.
Parents want better marks for all their kids, and policy offerings ranging from voucher systems to national literacy and numeracy standards would be keenly felt here.
Now we've got a question from Epsom Girls Grammar student Phoebe Jin. Phoebe.
If you were elected as MP for Epsom, what would you do for education?
The cake?
Kate, pick that up, please.
Well, the great thing about being the Labor candidate for Epsom and campaigning for the party vote is our proud track record in education. Under the leadership of Prime Minister Helen Clark, we've taken incredible strides at every single part of the education system. We've introduced 20 hours free early childhood education. We've brought in 6,500 more teachers into the schooling system beyond role growth. We've made sure that year one class sizes are one teacher to every 15 students. And we've also worked really hard on making sure tertiary education is accessible for all, including interest-free student loans, and now the introduction of universal student allowances, which I'm personally really pleased to see being introduced. So we believe in Labor that every young person should go to their local school, and therefore we support the zoning system. Thank you.
All right, we've already had that. We've already heard various opinions from the National supporters here, so Richard Worth, would you like to respond, please?
Well, National's got four education policies. The reality is that a large number of people move into Epsom because of the excellence of the system. NCEA has changed hugely. There are choices available in Epsom. Many people are taking up those choices, so we're seeing a number of people sitting the Cambridge exams. I think the most compelling difference between National and Labor on education is our focus on national standards. Because the reality is that one in five kids these days leaves school without appropriate qualifications. And there needs to be a real focus on literacy and numeracy. There are people in this audience who will remember so well the arithmetic drills we used to do. All of that stuff has gone. There's been a completely different focus on literacy.
I've been educated since the 1990s, and I've had a great education, and I've managed to come through
the national standards across New Zealand.
I mean, NCEA is a standards-based test. And so what he's talked about is national standards, and that's what we have under NCEA. All that national is offering is taking the free off 20 hours free early childcare and introducing league tables for primary schools,
okay,
and that's disgusting.
Let's give the candidates the chance to speak.
A couple of points. So the Greens, the Greens support... the Greens support NCA, and we can have proper national standards around NCA without having separate exams. And I think the picture is not as rosy as Kate painted. If you just walk 100 metres down the road in this school, you'll see a whole pile of prefabs. The Greens say there should be a 10% increase in the operational grants for schools. It isn't adequate at the moment. We need to reduce the class size, which at this school is too big. We need to reduce class size to 20, put more financing in, and we have got a debt monster of $9 or $10 billion that people who have been students owe. That is affecting their future and is part of the reason why we've got such a brain drain to Australia, which came out today in the record figures.
Right. Rodney, would you like to respond?
Sure. I think we all have an interest in the best education system that we can have in New Zealand, and I think that there have been some good things done under Labor, and I don't think we should oppose things that are good for education. Here are the things that I believe that we need to do. I actually do believe that you have a right to go to your local school. I think that is important. But I think that the Labor Party has got a wee bit captured by the teacher unions and the Ministry of Education bureaucrats. It would be better if they focused more on the pupils and the parents. I like National's commitment to standards because I think that's important. And what I'd like to see is not solo mothers having to crunch up in an apartment in Epsom to try and get to a decent school. I'd like to see decent schools right through New Zealand. And the way to do that is actually to have school choice. If you send your child to an independent school or a private school, you don't have to pay twice. Wouldn't that be a change?
Well,
and I think National agree with that.
Well, getting back to the issue of zoning, because it's such an important issue. Now, Lionel McDonald, who is a premier real estate agent in the area, how important an issue is it?
It's very, very important because it's getting very, very hard to get into Epsom Girls and Auckland Boys School. I think the Auckland Boys School is so crowded now, and it's coming to the stages. If you're not in the grammar zone, you don't get in. I've had people that one child has got into the grammar zone and they moved houses, so they moved out of the grammar zone and the child was taken away.
Okay.
It's very, very important.
All right, Kate, that's an argument against zoning, so why does Labor support it?
School zoning, it's incredibly important that young people can go to their local school. What we need to do is we need to keep cars off the road, we need to keep children walking to their local school and being able to access their local school. I agree with Rodney that we all schools should be excellent, and they all are. And I was really...
They're not.
Our teachers work incredibly hard. I have a massive amount of respect for the teachers that work in this country. They all work very, very hard, and there is still more to be done.
And the problem, okay, the problem is.
All right. I want to end this issue on a positive note that the teachers all work incredibly hard, and I want to look at something a little bit different now. Epsom, maybe Auckland's most affluent electorate, but even here, crime and law, and order, are an issue. Here's Wallace again.
Epsom is a relatively safe electorate, but the residents here are becoming increasingly concerned about the rising rate of violence, not just in Auckland but across New Zealand. Now, the recent murder in the inner city is a reminder of how violence is not just isolated to South Auckland.
The Sensible Sentencing Trust says people in traditionally safe electorates are feeling vulnerable.
You're thinking about the wider picture, you're thinking about friends or relatives that live in other parts of Auckland. I mean, yeah, it might be all right walking around Epsom and Rumiura during the day and think, oh, I'm all right, Jack, but... You come to town at night and you see a different side of things.
Mount Eden Prison is a holding pen for criminals from outside the area. Voters want dangerous offenders to stay there and not be let out to commit crimes like the stabbing of Auckland grammar student Augustine Burrell last year.
But at the end of the day, it's the politicians have got a lot to account for because they're at the top of the tree and they sculpture our society. So they're the ones who are moulding, I suppose, these young people into criminals.
Stamping out petty crime is a start. It was rife in Parnell before the Main Street Association got the police to sort it out.
There was broken bottles around, and misbehaviour, vomiting in some of the streets and petty crime break-ins and that around some of the fringe areas of Parnell. We had more patrol cars, which seemed to tidy a lot up. The graffiti has definitely disappeared.
It's that kind of law and order that Epsom residents want to see more of.
Now, we've got a question from student Samantha Zhang on this exact issue. Samantha.
With the escalating rate of violence in recent times, what are your plans to keep New Zealand streets safe?
Rodney Hyde.
We've got three key policies. The first is we need to establish a zero tolerance policy for crime. That means the police go after every crime and don't look the other way. I've just been up at the Parnell RSA and the secretary there was hit in the face badly, had to go to hospital several times, rang the police, they still haven't come. That was 2 weeks ago. So we need to have a zero tolerance for crime that we actually go after the taggers, the petty burglaries, and send a signal to the young offenders that crime doesn't pay. The second thing that we need to do is we do need to toughen up on sentencing. I think the National Party goes some way, but I think we can go further. We need to abolish parole totally. I think it's wrong that we have the family's victims having to go through the agony of a parole board hearing and relive the crime. And here's the key one, for violent offenders, three strikes and you're out. That would have saved 77... Well, it does work, sir, because there are 77 people who were murdered who, if we had three strikes and you're out, would still be alive. And I actually go and see their families and their victims, and you can sit there and say it doesn't work and smirk all you like, right? It does work. If we had that policy, they'd still be alive. And we stand here proudly as the ACT Party and as the MP for Epsom, standing up for each and every one of you to keep you safe.
I'd like, first of all... Richard Worth, we will come to you shortly. I just want to hear a response first from Keith Locke. Zero tolerance, no parole, three strikes and you're out.
Well, parole is important for a transition of the criminal into society, and rehabilitation is the key, because most of the violent offences, like the ones we saw on the TV screen, are committed by people who have already been in jail. And at the moment, the prisons, you just need to go down to Mount Eden Prison here, as I have, and they're schools for crime, not schools for rehabilitation. We've got to change that around. I would support a very... I would support a variation of three strikes and you're out. That is two strikes and you're out for white-collar criminals in the finance companies who diddled people out of their life savings. The same when they did it 20 years ago during the Rudgenomics period. They should... But I think that might deplete the numbers too much.
What about this, Keith? Like what about two strikes and you're out for the Prime Minister who's robbed all the money from the taxpayer? Two strikes and you're out.
The other part of the Green policy...
Or stealing if the Prime Minister okay.
..is to, at a community level, get the young kids when they're starting to move into crime, which means stopping them from dropping out of school and having nothing to do, giving them a decent education, and the best way of solving crime is giving people a job. And that's why the economic policies that we'll be talking about tonight are so important.
I'll come to Richard first. Richard Worth. Richard Worth. Will that sort of community approach work in Epsom?
Only partly. Here are three further points that I think are significant. The first is, if you can catch criminals with a high degree of certainty, you can significantly take away the motivation for crime. Because the one thing a criminal does not want is to be caught. National's got some very clear policies about a considerably expanded use of DNA testing. And if you go to a crime scene, you'll invariably find blood or semen or hair or something like that. We plan to do what they've done in the UK and build a significant database so that there can be very quick matching of offender and real evidence left at a crime scene. That's the first thing. The second thing is we do need to tighten up on parole. It is utterly unacceptable that there are substantial and serious offences occurring when criminals have been released on parole. And the third thing we have to deal with, and it was shown on the video before, we have to take a much harder attitude to organised crime and the manufacture and selling of drugs. Labour has failed in that area, failed completely.
Okay, I'm just going to give a quick last word to Kate. Give me a quick last word.
We need to look at the facts in this situation. We've put 2,500 more police on the street. We're solving 10,000 more crimes a year. We have the second highest incarceration rate in the world, and that
quick
is appalling. What we need to do is we need to focus on jobs, and we need to focus on education, and that's how we're going to get criminals off the street.
All right. I'm not going to come to your problem yet, Rodney. We might get to that later. But you've just said focusing on jobs. Well, that's where we should probably go at this stage. We're going to take another quick break. But coming up, arguably, the driving issue for this election, the economy.
Discover our history.
We had no idea what did happen was going to happen.
Our people.
And glide like a 747.
Our stories. By New Zealanders for New Zealanders. Made in NZ. Every day on TVNZ 7. Yes, they're problems.
One of the most staggering ecological disasters of the 20th century.
We're working on the answers.
The waters and fish have returned.
On Earth Report. Then on Unreported World. Forgotten victims.
1.5 million people have been moved ahead of the Olympic Games.
Fighting for survival.
Everybody here is out to control the drugs trade.
The battle for scarce resources.
They're abused in the street.
Information changes things. Earth Report, followed by Unreported World on TVNZ 7.
Remember the famous line from Bill Clinton's campaign in 1992? It's the economy, stupid. Well, maybe this election it is. New Zealand was already technically in recession when the banking crisis hit, and now growth looks likely to be static or minimal for at least the next year. Here's Wallace again.
The residents of the Ipswich electorate are some of the highest earners in the country. They're hard-working people who want to know they're getting value for their tax dollar, and they want sound management of the economy to ensure New Zealand's prosperity.
Almost half of Ipswich families earn $100,000 or more per year. That's the largest proportion of any electorate, so a reduction in the top tax rate is a hot topic.
I know I work very hard to pay a lot of taxes.
My tax is always way too high.
I'm quite happy to pay a reasonable amount of tax, provided it's exchanged for good hospitals and education.
But tax cuts alone won't be enough, not with the turmoil on world financial markets and recession on our shores. Epsom's Newmarket is the second biggest business district in Auckland. In good times, it helps boost the economy. But instead, the Newmarket Business Association says its members are struggling.
The government should have really taken the bull by the horns and looked at compliance costs and all the bureaucratic red tape that strangles business on a day-to-day basis.
It's not just current policy worrying voters. Local software developers say National's plan to axe the R&D tax credits is appalling.
They mentioned that they were going to drop the research and development budget, yeah. And I thought that was the worst thing they could ever do.
That's true. They talk about the brain drain in this country and then they go ahead and encourage it by trying to stop companies doing R&D work. It's not really for the best.
With tough economic times ahead, Epsom is looking for a candidate who will promote their prosperity.
Well, we've got a question from Susan Mackay, Epsom resident, living on a low-income solo mum. Susan.
I'd like to know what policies your parties would have for lower-income people, the single parents like me paying crazy rent so their kids can go to school in the zone, the immigrant families squashed in the flat across the road from me, and the elderly people who can probably barely pay their rates.
That's the other side. That's the other side of Epsom. Richard Worth.
Are you on a benefit at the moment or not?
No,
you're working. Okay, so I can answer that maybe more generally. Look, the last 9 years, in terms of the government's plans for economic transformation, have been a disaster. I can't physically identify one aspect where the economy has been transformed in a positive way. Basically, we've had 9 years of substantial profits which have been generated by the system. And that money has been wasted in low-quality spend. And so we've seen, for example, a substantial increase in bureaucracies like the Ministry of Education, like the Ministry of Health. What should have been done, is a strengthening of frontline services, of police, of teachers, of nurses, of doctors. That has not happened.
How will that look help? Richard Worth.
So what are we going to do?
How will
we're
that
going
help
to do five things. These five things start with personal tax cuts. They start with personal tax cuts. They go on from there to an infrastructure spend.
All right, we're not going to go through all five. Start with personal tax cuts. Kate.
As we're going through a recession, we need a government that we can trust to take us through the hard
I didn't know you were going to vote that.
When we came in 1999, we had a $22 billion government net debt. Now it's $2 billion. We inherited 161,000 unemployed people. Now it's an able government to take us through this time. And how do you do? How do you promote growth and investment? We promote through education, through investment, and through savings. And our key legacy policy has been KiwiSaver. And 827,000 proud Kiwi workers are in KiwiSaver, and they want KiwiSaver to support our economy. And the National Party have gone and wrecked it, and they've gone and cut it in half, and that's disgusting in a time like this. But I'm really embarrassed by that.
The way the Greens would help you is firstly to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour, which will raise all of the wage levels. And secondly, our tax policy, which isn't a tax cut because you need the total government revenue the same, particularly when you're moving into a recession, but we have a tax shift which would take the first, make the first $10,000 of income completely tax-free, which would help the poorest people the most, and gain that tax by a set of eco-taxes, which taxes the use of scarce resources or polluting industries to retain the tax revenue. And we would look after the economic future of your children by dealing seriously with questions of climate change, which are going to affect the future of your children and your grandchildren, and adapting to an economy where oil is going to be much dearer than it presently is because the world's running out. With public transport, Rodney Hyde. With public transport being important for that.
Okay, Rodney Hyde.
Suzanne, the trouble is this. For the last 10 years, government spending has almost doubled. What that means is over and above inflation, your family is being squeezed by $230 a week that the government is taking extra that it wasn't taking 10 years ago. That's why you're struggling. Here's what we need to do. Yes, we're going to have some hard times, because costs are going to go up because the dollar's going to fall. We need to cap the growth in government expenditure and actually allow you to have more money. If we don't get expenditure under control, then you're going to miss out. The second thing that we need to do is we need to get rid of the dopey red tape that is strangling business in this country. And I think and the third thing that we need to do is we need to dump the emissions trading scheme that is going to put your costs through the roof, make it harder for every business, the businesses that employ you, for no environmental gain whatsoever. It's got to go.
Well, okay, Susan, you've seen your way through the women policies. Who do you believe?
I'd just like to thank Auntie Helen for giving me Working for Families.
Thanks.
Suzanne, I need to say in response to that, Suzanne, that Working for Families will continue under National. There will not be change to that
until
system.
They cut one out, until the next term when they get rid of it, and Kiwi Bank, and KiwiSaver, and cut everything else.
One of the problems with Working for Families, and the Greens have supported it, is it leaves beneficiaries out in the cold. The benefits are at a lower level than before Ruth Richardson cut them in 1991. The Labor government has not brought them up. And if you get a Green Labor government, we will make sure the benefit levels are increased to an average.
Richard Wirth, you've just stood and you've defended Working for Families. Why did John Key, your leader, say a few years ago that he opposed Working for Families with every bone in his body?
He doesn't know what he believes in.
Well, we've had a hard look at Working for Families, and the issue really is that there are so many people subject to that regime now that it would be unfair to alter it. And we can see that there is an intrinsic merit in it.
No, because it's a visionary policy. What we need now is people who have vision who can take us through the tough times, and it's not coming from
National. If this tax cut regime, which National plans, is implemented in the way we propose, that it may be appropriate for it to be looked at. But we plan to continue it.
Rodney Hyde, do you have the vision to see us through tough times?
Do you know what I think is sad about your comment, Susan, is that you feel the need to thank Auntie Helen simply for getting to keep the money that you earn in the first place. That's what I find it true. And I'll tell you what I believe. I believe that we're better off allowing you to keep what you earn rather than have the government take it and then hand it back, and we feel the need to thank the Labor Party, because I think ultimately it's far better to keep the money that you earn in the first place. It's not a bad place to start.
And do you, Richard Worth, agree with that?
Yeah, I do agree.
So you think tax cuts could become more important than working for families?
Tax cuts are a central part of National's policy in a number of contexts, one of which is to encourage New Zealanders to stay in New Zealand, or alternatively from people offshore
extra
to
a week,
return.
Which is hardly going to be about $15 for middle-income earners.
Tax cuts
is
at least $50, and in many cases, much, much more.
Tax cuts will undermine the government revenue, and when we need a huge amount to build a decent public transport system for this city.
That's wrong. We need to enable substantial
infrastructure
spend across a range of asset
classes. Do you know what's undermined government revenue? The fact that it's this. No, I tell you this.
No.
It's because our economy is smaller now than it was at the start of the year. That's what being in a recession means. All funding is undermined if we don't grow a bigger economy. It's all very well for everyone to sit there and you can yell and scream about who should be getting what money, but unless we grow the economy, if we get a shrinking economy like we have now, like we have next year, there's going to be no funding for anything. That's why the Labor government has had to admit to a mini budget in December where they cancel all their promises.
Where are you going to get the money? Where's Rodney going to get the money to build his prison for his law and order policy if he's reducing taxes at the same time that in a recession the tax take is reducing, and yet Rodney wants to build all sorts of prison?
I just want to give a bit of a breather from the panel.
We have a change of government.
Excuse me, Rodney.
Excuse me, Wallace. The government that gave it to us.
OK, Wallace.
Well, let me know. Instead of shouting, let us know if you've got some questions. Hands up. Now, we've got a question here about the economy, but particularly about railways, from the AT quarter.
I'd like the candidates to comment about the purchase of the railway because of the fact that the new high cube containers
are going to be loaded onto
these trains and they won't fit through the tunnels. How are you going to pay for that?
Kate Sutton.
To fix that problem.
Under the leadership of Helen Clark and Michael Cullen, know that the most important thing to do at a time like this is help Kiwis to save and make sure that we invest. And part of that investment strategy has been bringing the railway back into Kiwi ownership, and Kiwis are incredibly proud of Kiwi Rail. And it's been one of the legacy policies of the Labor government. Thank you, Helen Clark.
What about the high cube containers that are going to be the only ones you can use?
I accept that the railway has been run down, there's problems with the tracks and the tunnels, etc. That is because of the policies of Roger Douglas and Ruth Richardson that privatised rail, and we're just getting it back on track now, and we're going to have to spend a huge amount of money, and that's why it's so stupid to go for major tax cuts at the present time.
We need to get our railway up to scratch.
Look, it says a lot about the economic thinking of this lot over here, that giving $700 million to the Australians is considered an investment in New Zealand. That is nuts.
Your mate ran it down in the 1990s.
How does giving $700 million to the Australians constitute an investment in New Zealand? I don't get it. Do you, Kate?
Well, Rorta, let's have the Greens have a say. Here we go. You've got a question, sir.
The New Zealand Herald, that priceless national asset, has suggested that GST rise to 15%. That is a very serious issue. I want the candidates tell me and the audience whether they're in favour of that or not, if I can believe them.
Okay, it wasn't actually the New Zealand Herald, it was Price Waterhouse who brought that up. Very quick response, Richard.
John Shearn said two things on behalf of that accounting firm. He predicted the price of GST would raise to that number. He also said that the rate of tax would significantly go up. National will not increase the rate of GST. We do not believe any of his predictions.
The Green Party, the Green Party is certainly committed not to increase the rate of GST, and when you walk into a shop, we also want proper labelling on labelling for all food, and National and Labor should explain
Gordon,
tonight.
We are getting ourselves around the debate here. A lot of questions. Here we go. One from the Labor camp, sir.
Well,
moving out of home. Can we hear the question, please? Country of origin labelling.
Moving out of home when you grow up and go to university or polytechnic, that's a rite of passage in New Zealand. But right now you're penalised for doing that because to get a student allowance, you're assessed on your parents' income right up to the age of 25. I'm wondering, what will your party do to ensure that if you're a young person and you want to invest and grow in higher education, you won't be penalised when you move out of home and become an independent person?
Kate. Well, the Labor Party, under the leadership of Helen Clark and Michael Cullen, have said that universal student allowance is something that we want to achieve, and education is a public good, and we should treat students like the adults that they are. Imagine men testing up to the age of 25. It's ridiculous. So by 2012, all students will be receiving universal student allowance, and that's on top of our amazing interest-free student loan scheme. That personally saved me thousands of dollars, which I put into paying for my first home. And I'm very proud of that.
Universal student allowance doesn't come into full effect until 2012. So it's a long, long distance policy.
What's National that's the providing first point. For students,
The
Richard?
Second point
Nothing.
About it is, as you possibly know, students are asked to basically bear 25% of the university fees, and the government picks up the balance 75%. That doesn't seem unreasonable to me, particularly also in a circumstance where there is the prospect of interest-free student loans. National's got a particular policy on student loans to keep them interest-free, but to also allow a very substantial rebate for early repayment.
The Green Party's position is to support the Labor plan to take away all those age qualifications. There should be a universal student allowance, and it should be adequate to live on. The fees should be reduced, and then the students would need to get these loans that put them into $30,000 debt.
The grim reality is this. Whoever wins the election, your rite of passage and the funding of it by everyone else in the room is sadly going to be cancelled, whoever wins the election. That's what the Labor Party is doing. That's why it's having a mini-budget in December, a month after the election. Because it's not prepared to tell you now.
The Labor Party understand that education is one of the three key pillars to increasing our productivity and growth in this country. And we know that investing in our students makes this country a great place and makes it a much more prosperous place. Thank you, students.
Well, let's hear from the National camp. Sir, you've got a question.
What is in the mini-budget?
Yeah, I'd like to ask Kate, given we're being told ad nauseam that we can trust Helen Clark and Michael Cullen and we can't trust anyone else, how can we trust a government that helped itself to $800,000 worth of taxpayers' funds and gave it back when they got caught with their hand in the cookie jar? That doesn't sound like a government you can trust.
Okay. The Electoral Finance Act is about big business and big money not winning elections. It's about every New Zealander having a democratic say and being involved in their elections. And I'll stand
before
by
the Electoral Finance Act. It's nothing to do with the Electoral Finance Act. Nothing to do with it.
We believe that it was legitimate party spending. And we paid it back, every single cent. Hard-working Kiwi members of the Labor Party paid it back.
OK, can I ask a quick question before we go back to Wallace on the floor? I just want to ask a quick question. Richard Wirth, I look at the National signs here and they're saying, choose a brighter future, party vote, party vote, party vote. We've got Rodney Hyde being voted for here, Kate Sutton. Is it more important to encourage a National party vote rather than your own individual vote in this electorate?
Yes, it is. And let me explain why that is.
We work so well together, don't we?
Well, no, I certainly want to know. Yeah. Richard.
Well, may I continue.
Richard, I simply
He's
want to know...
He's a very good Member of Parliament.
Richard, I simply want to know whether, and we all know it's in best interests of National Party who are seeking government here, to have Rodney Hyde and the ACT Party as a possible coalition partner in a 3 weeks' time. Have you given up on winning this seat for yourself?
Absolutely not. I'm still a constituency candidate. But the critical vote is the party vote because of the pure nature of MMP. You get 46% of the vote, party vote. You get 46% of the seats. So you have to concentrate on that vote. And if you look at all the hoardings around New Zealand, actually, they will say party vote National, party vote Labour, party vote Green.
And in my case, the way I'm going to be elected is through the party vote, because I'm number six on the list. Okay. I'll get elected through the party vote.
Another quick question. Sorry, Wallace, I just want one more quick question. In the last election, Kate Sutton, the Labour Party was quite keen on the Labour supporters voting National to try and keep ACT out of the picture. Is that going to be happening again from your personal perspective in this election?
At this stage, we're running a two-ticks campaign for Labour, so that's a candidate vote for Labour and a party vote for Labour.
Rawdon, let's go back to the Greens.
This one for Keith. Keith, what are we going to do to protect the economy against the rising price of oil?
Well, some people say the price has gone down temporarily, but if you look at any of the statistics, oil is running out and it will resume its upward march, particularly as we come out of the recession internationally, and it is important to reduce particularly the use of petrol in our transport by building a decent public transport system. By energy efficiency measures that reduce our reliance on fossil fuels.
Oil leads us very nicely into looking at the general economic picture we're at. So I want to hear from each of you individually about the general economic picture, where we're at, where we're going, and why you think there's a reason you should be sitting in the Epsom seat to try and help us along. We'll start here with you, Rodney, very quickly.
Oh, the economy is relatively strong, but we've got a problem with our current account deficit and our government deficit. We need to get government spending under control. We need to recognise that it's small to medium business that builds the economy and provides the jobs, and we need to get rid of the red tape. I'm sick of Helen Clark.
OK, we've heard about the red tape already.
What we can eat and when we can smack our kids and what light bulb we've got to use.
Richard Worth.
And
Richard
Worth. Shells.
Thank you, Rodney. Richard Worth.
Well, I think we're in for a very tough time. And we're in for a tough time because bank finance is going to significantly tighten up, and that's for people who want loans or for people who want to extend loans. We have a five-point economic plan. Without getting into any of the detail of it, it includes personal tax cuts, regulatory reform, dealing with the bureaucracy, national focus on standards.
Keith. Our economy's in great difficulty.
We know that.
Partly because of the takeover.
What are you going to do for it? One sentence.
Try and stop and reverse the takeover of our economy, which is causing great difficulty, and plan for a future with climate change and peak oil.
All right,
the reason why Richard Worth can't give you an answer as to what their plan is, because they haven't got one. Under Helen Clark, we have got a great plan which involves investing in education, investing in our road infrastructure.
All right. Okay. All right, Kate, we're going to let
Wallace
wrap up.
That's it. Camp Epsom, that's us. Who do you think won the debate? Who won the debate? Was it Labour?
No!
Was it National?
Yes.
Maybe it was the Greens? Or was it Camp Rodney High?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Wallace. It'll be fascinating to see what happens on election night. And that's it for this last Swing Seats debate on TVNZ7. And you can see the debate at any time on TVNZ On Demand. You can log in at www.tvnz.co.nz. You can see it again on TVNZ7 at 10 past 12 tomorrow or at 10 past 9 on Saturday night. A final thank you to our candidates. Thank you also, of course, to our audience and to you at home for watching. Bye-bye.